gift. We're so honored today to have with us to minister today Brother Dennis McGuire, who is no stranger among us. He's been here many times, and he's going to bless us today with the Word of God. Now, I want to share with you how I came about asking Brother McGuire to be here today. August the 4th of this year, his grandson, his oldest grandson, fell out of the back of a pickup truck, breaking his ankle, two bones in his legs, and fracturing his skull. And he was in an induced coma for over a month. The doctors gave him up and said he will not live. Today, he is at Shepherd's Center near Piedmont, going through rehab, having been touched by God's hand, literally around this globe. People have been praying for Tanner McGuire. And when I found out that Brother McGuire was going to be in the area today, I asked him to come and speak with us. Now, at the end of the service, the ushers will be at the back door, and I want us to give a liberal gift to Brother McGuire, thanking him for his work, preaching in 79 countries of the world, having traveled widely, carrying the gospel. I want us to honor him today at the close of the service. On your way to the fellowship hall, put a liberal gift in the receptacle for Brother McGuire. My heart has been heavy for this family since August the 4th. He and I go back many years. I knew Tanner when he was first born. In fact, I knew Tanner's dad when he was born. But they have needed a touch from God, and God touched them. And I'm honored today to introduce to you our speaker, former general overseer of the Church of God, Brother Dennis McGuire. Brother McGuire, come.
Well, what a privilege it is to be here today, to be back in this church. I'm honored that the pastor would ask me to come by today. I think it's always an honor to preach in this church. The reason I like to preach around here, there's a bunch of worshipers around here. Yeah. Self-starters, nobody has to push you. You're ready to have church. Amen. What a blessing. Well, congratulate Grant today. It's got to be a big day to have Jack down here and get this thing started here now. And to write a book on top of that. I'm kind of afraid to write a book myself. I'd incriminate too many people. One of them sitting to your right down there, you know. Well, I'm just delighted to be here with Keith and Brenda. And for this special day to be here, I will be taking my grandson home, Lord willing, October the 10th from Shepherd's. The day that all the cell phones went out, had a blanket area where we live, was the day that this unfortunate thing happened. And somehow they got a call through on my phone, and by the time the ambulance got to Erlanger, I was there. I thought it was the darkest day of my life. My 19-year-old grandson was in a coma, unresponsive, and for 30 days we sat there bated breath all every day, trusting the Lord, and we were not discouraged. The last time 2 days before the accident, he called me and he said, "Papa, I hear you're going to be at Mount Olive tonight. I really want to hear you preach." So he came over with his two little cousins, sat on the front row at Mount Olive. And, you know, I was kind of proud of my grandson. And I just thought, what a wonderful thing that he wanted to come hear me preach. And he came. And so I was talking to him yesterday. I said, "Do you remember being there?" "Oh, yes, I remember there. You were sitting on the other side with Brother Sears, the pastor, and said you had Dr. Lowry with you, and said he kept telling you he wanted to hear you preach." I could hardly remember all that stuff myself, Ernestine. I'm sitting there thinking, I might need a lick in the head myself, amen? That is an absolute miracle of God. I was going to preach 2 weeks ago, and it was the first time I was preaching since this situation happened, and the devil got in the car with me and said, "What you going to preach on today?" I said, "Divine healing." "You going to preach on divine healing?" "No, I'm just going to tell them about it. I'm going to let God do the preaching." So I was going there with my situation very dark at that point. And as I was sitting on the platform, not knowing, I'm not ready to preach today, I don't need to preach, and it ain't a good day to preach, and where are you, God, and that sort of thing, you know. I get a text. My son said he's sitting up for the first time. I just got up and told him what the Lord had done. He started performing miracles in that church. I mean, miracles that you could see happen. I kind of feel like that's what's about to happen around here today. Somebody's not going to leave like you came, in Jesus' name. Some folks, it's not been serious about it. You're about to see the glory of God, because God's going to show some things happen. You've been wondering if it's real, and you're going to know it's real because you're going to see the glory of God, because we're coming in the last days. Amen. Something is about to happen in this world, and something is about to take place, and I believe it is the coming of Jesus Christ. The whole world is ready. The whole world is ready. If you wouldn't mind, please, to stand with me for the reading of the Word of God. I'm going to read from the book of Habakkuk. It's on page 765. If you get to Matthew, make a left-hand turn and come back real careful, and you'll read the H-A-B-A-K-K-U-K. What a name. And the only thing I can say is, in Spanish, they call it Habakkuk. Yeah, I see a few folks know a little bit of Spanish, Habakkuk, and that's not bad. What a crazy name. Anybody, I don't know of a kid anywhere in the world named Habakkuk, do you? I heard somebody name a kid Pism Siv, and the preacher said, "What have you done?" "Oh, my Lord, you've named him Psalms 104. That's not what you need to name him." So you see, all through the Scripture, people talk about good names. Well, here's one, Habakkuk. Habakkuk the prophet. I want to read to you beginning at verse 1 of chapter 2, and here's what it says. It says, "I will stand up on my watch and see. Set me upon a tower, and I will watch to see what he will say unto me, and what I shall answer when I am reproved. And the Lord answered me and said, Write the vision. Make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. And behold, his soul, which is lifted up, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith." Chapter 3, verse 2. "O Lord, I have heard thy speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive thy work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make known in wrath and remember mercy." Father, thank you for your word. Speak to us today. Speak to us today that we may leave this place anchored in Jesus, full of faith and believing you for the impossible. We pray, oh God, you touch me today in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, let's talk a little bit about Habakkuk. This was a critical time in the history of the people of God. It was a time that it looks like they have gone too far. Isaiah, Jeremiah, they all prophesied it's going to happen. It's going to take place. And Brother Swilly, when you read the fall of Israel and the fall of Judah, how that they lost the capital, they lost the temple, they lost everything. And their young men were carried away into captivity all the way over to Babylon. And their children were killed, and their wives and their daughters were molested and beat up. And it was a horrible time. But all these men kept warning, it's going to happen, it's going to happen, it's going to take place. Sometimes we get to the point of no return. And I read this portion of Scripture, and I think about this name, Habakkuk. Habakkuk. Pastor, let me borrow you just a minute. Habakkuk means to hug or embrace. Sometimes, you know, people say the stupidest things when you get in a mess. You can have one leg all bandaged up, hanging up in some kind of traction, your neck pulled back the other way, and somebody walk in and say, trust God. Makes you like, I just like to reach out there and grab you by the chin whiskers and see how you trust him. Sometimes, don't be quoting Scripture, Grant. Sometimes things just don't work out. I've said some stupid stuff to people and wondered why I said stupid stuff like that. So God, at a crucial time, sends a messenger. His name meant to hug. You ever been to a place you couldn't tell anybody anything, you just haul off and give them a good hug? You'd like to say, I'd like to explain it. You can't explain it. All you can do is hug them. Pull them up and embrace them. Isn't this amazing? Thank you, Pastor. Isn't it amazing that God has named a prophet to hug or to embrace? I want to pull you close to myself, even though you can't understand what's going to happen. I'm going to tell you this. I care for you, and I'm going to see you through. Since this is just three chapters, let me give you an outline. Somebody said chapter one was the sighing or the crying of the prophet. Chapter two is the seeing of the prophet. And chapter three is the singing of the prophet. It is a natural way that this man gets from crying and sighing over to singing and shouting. Is there anybody here like to get out of them? Sighing and the crying over into the singing and the shouting. That's the journey I want to take today. I want to get from sighing and crying over to shouting. I can also look at this portion of Scripture and I can say chapter one is the rejection and chapter two is a revelation and chapter three is a revival. Oh, my. Oh, my. Do you know what rejection is all about? Sometimes it seems like your best friends leave you somewhere on the road as you go along. I have had occasions where people would see me walk in and sit down, and they would get up and move because they was afraid they would be identified with me. Have you ever been to a place that you just literally felt absolutely a square peg in a round hole? You know how it was when you was a kid and they used to get out and they'd choose up baseball teams. And somebody choose this big guy, choose this guy, and finally you get right down to last and they like one having a team, one over a team, and you get to sit out. How rejected you feel? Does it make you feel rejected sometimes when you go home and it looks like that they care more for somebody else in the family than they do you, and you just feel like you was an extra tag along? Rejection comes that way. Sometimes you get all this stuff that you think you're going to do for God, and you just get really excited, and you jump in the middle of it, and nobody listens to you. You just feel rejection. Well, this is what happened to Habakkuk in chapter 1. Habakkuk is coming for God. He said, now, God, look, I can't believe you're going to abandon us. And the first question Habakkuk asked, he said, oh, God, how long will I cry unto you and you will not answer me? I don't suppose as a person in this place it's felt like that. You said, God, I have prayed and I have prayed. And where in the world are you? I have asked you, God, please come to my rescue. And I can't get a word out of you. Then he says, and God, I'd like to ask you something else. Why do you let me see iniquity? Why do you let me see sin? Sometimes you see something, you know, you get your mind on a person, you ain't got a dab of confidence in them. You go to church, they'll get to shouting. If you ain't careful, they'll fall in your lap so you can't get a thing out of the service. Why do you let me see the hypocrites? Why do you let me see the problem? Why don't you just quit messing with me if this is the way it's going to be? And then he says, now, God, why is the law slack? Why ain't they doing something about it down at the church? Of all places, they ought to do something about it down at the church, but the law is slack. You know, I really got some questions out of you, God. What in the world is going on here? Is there anybody sitting in this place today and you feel like you say, Lord, have mercy? What's going on? Is it too late? Is it too late for a nation that will take little children and abort them and sell their little hands and sell their little hearts and little livers? Is it too late for a generation of people that take life as meaning nothing or ride by and shoot you just cause you're on the road? Is it too late for a generation that's afraid to send their children to school because they don't know how they're going to come home? Is it too late for a nation that rules God out of a party platform? Is it too late? Where are you, God? Where are you in America? Where are you in my life? Where are you? Now, I've come down to church here. I've come down here, and I've come to church today. But what about this sorry, cantankerous man I'm married to? Where is he? I want to know where he is. Then something happens. It's like God takes the pen away from Habakkuk. I said, you're not going to write anymore. I'm about ready to write something. Then God says, I will work a work in your day that if it were told you what I was going to do, you would not be able to believe it. Now that's the time to put up a tent, call the highway patrol, let them direct all the people in off the traffic because they're coming from everywhere. Oh, no, 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 no. He said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise up the Chaldeans, a bad country. And they're going to come in, and their horses are going to be swifter than eagles, and they're going to fly among you, and they're going to devastate your house. They're going to take everything you got and lead you into captivity. They will literally destroy you. Well, that wasn't what I wanted to hear. I wanted to hear about a three-week revival where 97,000 people got saved. I didn't know he was going to do that to me. Have you ever prayed a prayer and God said, okay, here's your answer. You ain't so smart, buddy. You pray a prayer, you want God to fill in the blanks. This is what's happened to me in my life. I buried a 59-year-old mother one time and I said, what are you doing, God? Where are you coming from? Why are you doing this to me? And I would say sometime in your faith walk, every one of you found that somewhere along your line. And now he says, before I quit asking questions, I'd just like to ask you one more question, God. Why do you pick up somebody that's more mean and vile than we are and let them do your work? It is amazing who God uses. But it lets you know that what's going on today is not without the knowledge of God Almighty. God God Almighty knows that there's a million people trying to get away and rush into Europe today. God Almighty knows that ISIS is trying to invade. God Almighty knows that Putin is set up in Syria. But God Almighty knows that I was young, but now I'm old, but I never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed out begging for bread. Even in the midst of despair, God is aware. And these are the works of God. And God's going to take care of his children. Now, you say there's something about this. I got to that place a time or two. Boy, ain't no place to sit down up here, praise God. All right, God, I can't figure you out. I'm going to sit right down here. I'm going to see what you're doing. Sure ain't the way I figured it out. I want to sit right here. I'm going to get up in a watchtower where I can see a little bit out. What are you doing? And while he's sitting there, the vision comes. He said, write it down, boy. It shall come to pass. It will not tarry. It will take place. Even though some think it's not going to happen, I'm in chapter 2 now, moving on real good. He said in chapter 2, I will watch and see what you will say unto me, and I will see here, and I will understand until your anger is removed. And the Lord said, write the vision, put it plain. I tell you, you need to write the vision today and put it plain on your hearts. He said, carve it out in rock and pour hot lead in it so you can see what it's like. This is what I want to tell you. He said, behold, his soul, which is lifted up in him, is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Here it is. Here's the revelation. It's right in the middle of it. And it's a revelation for you today. I don't care how the devil's lied and hollered and raised sand in your life. I'm come by to tell you he can't do a thing to you because he didn't give it to you. And he can't take it away. And you're not citizens of a main country, but you're citizens of Almighty God. I've come to declare to you, when you see what he's got to say, you shall never die. They may put an obituary in a newspaper somewhere that says you're dead. Get somebody to tear it out and laugh at it, because you're going to be more alive that day than you've ever been alive. There's some things that cannot be touched. You cannot be touched because you're the redeemed of God. God made you, and you're in the hollow of his hands. He wants you to know you've got to run with this vision. It doesn't matter who gets in power, Democrats, Republicans, or anybody else. They're not in control of you. God's in control of you. So he says, the just shall live by his faith. You know, this is one of the most important scriptures in all the Bible. Why does it show up 3 more times? Because it brings out the fullness of the revelation. That's why. What does it say, first of all? He said, the justified man by his faith shall live. You want a revelation today? It's called justification. What is justification? It's just as though it never happened. What are you talking about? It's just as though it never happened. I don't care what you've been into, what you've done, what somebody says about you. If you've been to Calvary, you don't have a past. The only thing you have is a future, because old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Back in Roman days, if you kill somebody, the punishment for the murder was that they would tie their dead body to your back. And you would carry that dead body as it decayed and eat into your body, because you kill that person and you carry that with you. It's like sometimes the sins of our life, we carry them with us and we feel loaded down because we feel ashamed and we feel sorrow. But Paul says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. You know why? Because in Romans 6, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 16, it says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, the Jew first and also the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed through faith to faith. For it is written, for the just shall live by faith." You don't need to go into battle worrying about your past, because your past is underneath the blood. Lift up your heads and declare the Lord is on your side. That's why he says to us, "Because I'm justified, all things work together for the good of them that love God and called according to his purposes." Because I'm justified, because it's in the past, because it's over, I know that nothing shall separate me from the love of God, neither power nor principality, nor things present, nor things to come, nor any other creature shall height, nor death, nor any other creature can separate me from the love of God, because old things have passed away. The sin is gone, and I'm justified by the faith I have in Jesus Christ. If you're here and you're hanging your head, say, "Well, I robbed somebody. I beat somebody up. I shot somebody up." No, you didn't. That was the person you used to be. But you're not that anymore. You're redeemed. You've been justified. It's no longer there. What a gospel, what a place, what a house to go to, a house that you can walk into regardless of what's happened. It's outside, because in here we are justified by faith. Hallelujah, we shall never die. I tell you, some people get all tied up, messed up. A lot of times it comes by faith. Isn't it amazing? Again, here in Hebrews 10, 38, "Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him." And then he starts, "Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." Evidence of good report. And he says, "By it the elders obtained a good report." He tells us that without faith it is impossible to please God. "For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of him that diligently seek him." You know, sometimes I really have a problem with faith. I don't know about you. Sometimes I think that what I want is the evidence and not the faith. I want to hold it in my hand. I want to have it in the bank. You know what I'm saying? You can't always get it in the bank. You can't always hold it in your hand. But when I read about this great commentary on faith called Hebrews, here's what he says. He starts into a testimony meeting. You know what a testimony meeting is? We used to have them until people got so ridiculous they get up and tell you about all their surgeries and everything else and tell on everybody and bore you absolutely to death. They used to get, "I'm saved, sanctified, baptized, the Holy Ghost, paid up, prayed up, ready to go up. Hallelujah." "Or I went to see Dr. So-and-so, and he sent me to see Dr. So-and-so, and I went over and saw that. Just the same stuff my mama had." But I tell you, I don't hear that junk. But when you look at the book of Hebrews, he said, "The just shall live by faith." Then he starts into a testimony meeting. "Oh, Abel offered up a better sacrifice. Enoch was not, because God took him." Oh, yeah. "Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." Remember that? And you keep on going. He said, "How about Abraham? He got up and started looking for a city whose builder and maker is God." And poor old sister Sarah. Sarah was 100 years old, and God said, "You're going to have a baby." She needed to get to Walmart and get her diapers, because things are picking up around her house. When God tells you it's going to happen, it's going to happen. You can go ahead and talk about Samson. You can talk about Barak. You can talk about David. Oh, what testimonies they had. But right in the middle of the chapter, here comes the curveball. Here comes the slider. Here comes the drop. Oh, what is it? He said, "Some were cut in two. Some were hit with the rocks and were stoned." And I have to be careful and explain stone, you see, because some people think they were really stoned. No, but they were hit with stones. And here was the problem. They did not get relief. They died. Died. Oh, yeah. They died. The Bible says, "Of whom the world was not worthy." Let's make sense out of this. If you're going to fight the devil, you got to know you're justified. And somewhere in your mind, you had to settle the question. He is real and he is mine. You only when you get to where you can say, if you don't give me another piece of bread, if you never answer another prayer for me, I settled. My God, I feel Holy Ghost in this house. I settled the question. I made up my mind. My God is real. And I want to just step up there beside a Job and say, I know my Redeemer liveth. And though the skin worms devour this body, yet in my flesh shall I see the Lord. Oh, hear me now, brother. I'm come by to tell you there's a place you can get to in God. And you can say, now, God, look, I've got faith that it's going to work out and everything's going to be okay. You can walk out of this church today and say, it's going to change because I got faith in Almighty God. It's about time we got this thing straight. God will never leave you nor forsake you, but he'll go with you all the way, even in the world. I was riding down the road the other day and I was praying, oh God, heal my boy, heal my boy, heal my boy. Holy Spirit just seems to say, well, there's been enough people prayed. I'll give you what you want, but wouldn't you like for me to do it my way? Oh, I had to stop and say, whoa. I made my son mad, but he couldn't understand it. But somewhere in my mind, I had to say, it is not going to affect me. I've seen the greatest miracle I've ever seen in my life in my grandson. But if it had not have happened, it would not shake my faith in Almighty God one iota, because he lives, he lives, he lives. You can't fight until you determine, I will not capitulate. I won't give up. I won't surrender. I'll hold on to God because God is alive and well in my life. Oh, Lord, man, I feel revival fire in this church, the Holy Ghost. Listen, you're not the man you used to be. You made up your mind that you're going to serve God and you're going to keep on getting up. Every time the devil knocks you down, you're going to get back up because your faith still holds. Then he said, shall live. There's a great commentary on life and freedom called Galatians. Galatians 3:11 says, no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident the just shall live by faith. Now, all those people over at Galatia, they got saved. And here come the Judaizers. I got saved. You have. Have you been circumcised? Oh, no, no. Well, maybe you're not saved. People always try to add something to Jesus. Boy, when I was a kid, I had it figured out. I don't smoke, and I don't chew, and I don't go with girls that do. So help me, some people have only got enough religion to make them miserable. And they make everybody else around you miserable. I remember the day when beauty shops would send you to hell. Especially if you put one of them hoods over your head, you know. We couldn't even watch television. They hid it in the back room. These preachers were afraid to put an antenna on the parsonage. They'd get rabbit ears and crawl in the closet and watch it. We spent a whole generation living on externals and legalism, and we never understood. If you're going to make it, you've got to be refreshed in the power and the glory of the Lord. He said, Nehemiah, aren't you tired? Oh, no, I'm not tired. I'm laying brick with one hand, a knife on the other side. But I want to tell you one thing. I tell you, the joy of the Lord is my strength. I live, yet not I live, but Christ lives in me in the life which I now live. I live by faith in the Son of God. I'm telling you, it's about time you got your shouter to shouting. It's about time you got your shoe heels to clicking. It's about time you got your hands to God and you begin to praise him and to glorify him and to worship him and come alive in the power of God. Come alive in the Spirit of God. Well, God gets happy and shouts. Why should you sit like a bump on the log? Get everything you can out of an old-fashioned praise gathering like this, and when you go out, have your fire in your soul so ignited that you'll say, something is burning inside of me. It's the life of a Christian. Makes sense to me. If I'm justified and I don't have to perform another miracle, I don't have to do some kind of shake and bake to get you or hit you in the head and knock you down to make you. No. I made up my mind. Amen. This is right. Amen. It's not something I've seen. No. Well, it's this book right here. Oh, Lord. I've seen it. Oh, Lord. Write it down. Make it plain. Carry it everywhere. Tell everybody about it. This is the convincer. It cannot be any other. That's my faith. So I'm going to shout about it. I'm going to shout about it. Then Habakkuk starts making fun of people that's got idols. And he saw. And then he comes over to chapter 3. And he says, oh Lord, revive thy works. Man, that's a hard prayer to pray. Maybe you ought to pray that in your life. Lord, take over. You came from Mount Parham. You came from, not up here, but you came from Timnath. You came from these places. You made the desert move us bloom. You caused the Red Sea to open. You did all that stuff. Just revive your, you revive it. Because I made up my mind, you're going to take care of me. It's going to be okay. Everything's going to work out all right. Because my faith holds and my joy is in the Lord. I'm going to make it. I guess you've heard of country music. Put it up on the board, although the fig tree shall not blossom. Last part of chapter 3 of Habakkuk. You know what country music is, don't you? That's when they steal your pickup. And your wife and your dog were in there. They bring your wife back and they keep your pickup and your dog. If there's ever been a case for country music, it's the last four verses of chapter 3. Here's what starts off. Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall there be any fruit in the vine, the labor of the olive shall fail. There shall be no meat in stall. Comes on down there. Look at it. He says, yellow, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stall. Don't that sound like bad times? This is actually, Grant, supposed to be sung by the minister of the music. He's supposed to do this number. It'd wear me out. Sing the sad song. Although the fig tree shall not blossom. Put the words back up, brother. I'm listening here. Our fruit on the vines, the labor of the olive shall fail. And there shall be no field, no yield, no food. Though the flock be cut off from the fold, there shall be no more herd in the stall. Well, what are you going to do since you got over your rejection and you've seen it and now you got the revelation? Here's what he said. I will rejoice. I will rejoice. Ernestine, somebody told me one time that Paul looked over to Silas and they were locked up in jail. He said, Silas, ain't that a red back hymnal over there? Yeah. Turn it to 93 and sing He Set Me Free. Amen. anybody can sing when the sun is shining bright. You want a real song, you get a revelation from God, then you can sing. He said, yet I will rejoice. I'm not going to hang my head down. We've been beat up. We've been put aside. We've been hooked up in this jailhouse, and we're going to praise the Lord. We're going to glorify God. Oh, that we would start praising Him. It's amazing what praising will do. It'll bring you out of your shadows. It'll bring hope to you. It will bring revival to your soul, because when you sing praises to God, angels join with you and glorify God. Oh, praise be unto God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Rejoice. Rejoice, O Christian. Lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ, our King. Now stand up with me, please, if you would. Well, you say, I don't have a thing to praise God for. I can join. Oh, yes, you do. He said, I will joy in the God of my salvation. You may not have $50 in the bank, and every envelope you get's got a wind in it, but I tell you, you're still saved. If your refrigerator don't refrigerate, you're still saved. If the car doesn't crank, you're still saved. If you got a pink slip last week, you're saved. The devil didn't give it to you, and the devil can't take it away. Save, save, save. Anybody in this house, save. Anybody here, save, save, save. Glory, I'm saved. I'm saved by the blood of the crucified one. Well, you haven't seen my x-rays. So what? You're saved. You haven't seen my record. So what? You're saved. You don't know what I'm facing. So what? You're saved. What's going to happen if Social Security fails? You're still saved. It doesn't matter. You put it all aside. I was young, but now I'm old, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed out begging for bread. I'm saved. Come here a minute, Pastor. He says he makes my feet like hind's feet. That's where you are sometimes. You don't even know what God's sparing you from. There's some of you, you've been protected, and you don't even know what God protected you from. He said he makes my feet like hind's feet. It's like a mountain goat going up the mountain. He stands on his back feet, but he takes his front feet and he finds solid ground. When he finds solid ground, he jumps. His back feet hit where his front feet found solid ground, and they call that trekking. He's going up the mountain. Sometimes in your life, the devil thought he had you. You've been trying to find solid ground. Don't you let me catch you, preacher. But when the devil thought he had you, you don't know it. You come in church today. You say, I'm not feeling too good. I've come here. I'll tell you, this will be my last service. Not now, honey. Because your heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise or fears dismay. Your game, your power, your hope is higher ground. Lord, lead me to higher ground. To get there, you got to put your faith in Almighty God, that no matter what happens, you know He's looking out for your good. To get there, you know you're not indicted by your past, but you're free because you're alive in the power of the Holy Ghost. There's a bunch of people been going on some trials this place. You've been facing some heavy loads. You've been wondering. You've been asking God, where are you? And I do the same thing. Don't think there's anything wrong with it. But you need a touch of God. You need it today. I want you to come the next 2 seconds. Get out of your seat. Come down here and stand. We're going to believe God to do a work in your life. Come as quick as you can. I mean, come with your hands raised. Come praising. He's the joy of my salvation. Come on.